so much, VetTix. Our family has gone through a lot the last few years, and this gave us a nice break.
Every empty seat at a concert, game, or special event is a missed opportunity to say thank you to a veteran or a service member. By giving your extra tickets to VetTix, you'll help America's heroes reduce stress, strengthen family bonds, and create a truly happy memory that will last a lifetime. So when you really want to say thank you for your service, give the experience. Give the memory. VetTix. Give something to those who gave. For more information on how you can make a difference, go to vettix.org.
The new 1010 WOLB with talk in the day and soul at night. WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African American community for over 42 years.
Mississippi, surrounded by for world that ain't so pretty. His parents give him love and affection to keep him strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city. His father works some days for 14 hours, and you can bet he barely makes a dollar. His mother goes to scrub the floors for many, and you best believe she hardly gets a penny. Living just enough for the city.
All right, we are back for the second hour of the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host Tehma Smith-Wilson is not with us this weekend. She's taking care of some things. We wish her well and hope she's having a good time. And the Dean, Robert Bob Dashiell.
Good morning, Baltimore, again. Happy to be with you, still on this side of Jordan. And good morning again to our special guest, Robert Wallace, if he can still hear us. And hopefully the connection will be strong enough that we'll be able to hear him as he speaks in response to questions from our callers.
And yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number is 410-669-1738. Several announcements. Again, tomorrow and Sunday is the Caribbean Carnival Festival out at Druid Hill Park this year. And the parade is going to start, I think, at 12 noon in the 5400 block of Park Heights Avenue down into the park. And then again, tomorrow is also the what seems to be an annual craft feast from the United House of Prayer for All People, 3401 Edgewood Road. Tickets are $75. If you want a ticket to go, get in touch with Robin Oliver at 410-493-2211. That's 410-493-2211. We the first hour we had as our guest, Robert Wallace, former candidate for mayor of Baltimore. However, he's up in a mountainous area, wherever he is, and we've had some problems with him dropping off. We hope maybe he will get back to us in this hour because we have some folks that have some questions. But, if he doesn't, we're going to go on anyhow because there's a lot of things going on. Now, some you may have heard Doc Cheatham just call in and say that Towson State University is now replicating a course that Morgan had, and there had been a lawsuit about that, and they you know, this was a great thing that they that we're talking about, but we also had some questions on Doc about this very issue, because I really never understood about that issue completely, because most of the universities have duplicated courses, duplicated undergrad and graduate degrees. So I did not know where this was coming from, and Bob Dashiell kind of explained it because he was involved in the original lawsuit.
Right.
Bob, you want to let our listening audience know again how that lawsuit came about and what it's up to today and why you dropped out of the lawsuit.
Okay. And for me to do that, I've got to take you a little bit back in time prior to the filing of that lawsuit by the so-called coalition. I've got to take you back to Brown v. Board of Education. And the reason is Brown v. Board of Education established as a matter of law that black schools were legally and necessarily inferior. And so therefore the and that the solution to that problem was to take was to take the black kids and send them to the white schools where they could get a better education. Now, of course, that premise is false, but that is in fact the premise that undergird the coalition lawsuit. The coalition lawsuit was based upon the premise that in order for Morgan State University or any of the black schools that were part of the plaintiff's side of the case, in order for those schools to get the political commitment to fund them adequately, they had to have programs that would attract white students. In order for them to attract white students, the white schools couldn't have the same programs, because the premise was that the white students would go to the white schools and not go to Morgan or the black schools, and that would mean that the Morgan and the black schools would not have the political commitment to maintain the level of funding necessary for their continuing existence. That was the premise. I disagree with that premise. Because again, it ultimately goes back and relies upon the notion and incorporates the notion that the black schools are legally inferior, and the only way to overcome that is to reduce their blackness by attracting white students.
Okay, and that's the reason you dropped out.
That is the reason why. Okay. After staying in it long enough to get the suit filed, I insisted that my appearance be stricken almost immediately after that.
Okay. Bob Wallace is back with us. Thank you, Bob, for getting back to us, because we got a full board with folk probably got. Now, we're coming in this order. Janet, James, Jen, Priera, and William. In that order, if you got a question for Mr. Wallace, bring it right to it. Because we are having a lot of people call in today, which is great. Let's go with Janet. Janet, you on air, Janet.
Hey, how is everybody? And I really want to sit down and talk to Mr. Dashiell, because your premise is off. And I can give you so many examples that I've lived through to tell you why some duplications are wrong. Ask James Brown, ask Sam Cooke. If it don't make a difference who sings the song, why are they making the money and I'm not? And money is the bottom. The first thing for all of these aggravations and things that they copy and take from us, because they want the money. But I'll call them because of the BGE thing that I have just found out. So much information that really makes me sick. I want everybody to know that on Monday, July 10th, at 2 o'clock in the Mitchell Courthouse, they'll be having another hearing. And at that hearing, hopefully they will bring out the fact that once BGE puts those outside gas meters on your house, they become your responsibility, your problem. Those things are not built in a way to withstand extreme cold or extreme heat. But if it's on the homeowner's property, that makes it your responsibility for whatever might go wrong. Cars running into it, kids playing with it, whatever could happen to that thing to release gas. And that is a big issue that they are not telling people. If you're going to attach something to somebody's property, you should have them understand everything that is involved for them to get a release. And BGD is not doing that.
When's that meeting, Janet?
It's going to be in the courthouse. Mitchell Courthouse, a hearing on Monday, July the 10th at 2 o'clock.
July 10th at 2 p.m.?
Yes.
Okay, Mitchell Courthouse.
Yes.
Okay, now, do you have a question for Mr. Wallace?
Well, yeah. If he was in charge, how would he handle BG&E? Because this is turning from Baltimore City to BG&E City. They get anything and everything they want. And these people that are going around attaching these things are telling any kind of lie that they want out of their mouth to make people do it.
Okay. Bob, can you answer that?
Well, I think that part of the issue is we should always involve the community in decisions that impact the community. So I do agree that this discussion needs to go on at a detailed level to do what's best for the community, you know, and BGE. Being the engineer, guys, I know what's involved in terms of building infrastructure for energy, whether it's gas or solar or wind, whatever the case might be. And so I think that the discussion around that needs to take place and needs to occur with the community involved.
Okay, James, you were going to say something?
No, go ahead.
Okay. James, you're on air.
Hey, how you guys doing? This is James from Pennsylvania. How you guys doing today?
All right, man.
Yeah, I grew up in Lexington Terrace. I used to live in the 770 Saratoga Street building. One thing I remember, and this is to the hopefully future mayor, Mr. Robert, they had a wreck across the street where the school was at. I always thought that they should have double the amount of wrecks in the inner cities because the wreck was a place that we would go to for resources. Like, you don't get that no more. Now you got these kids, they running wild. They sit in the house playing video games all day. And it's like there's no progress. And when you got idle time on your hands, you find out ways to do, devious things. They say idle time is when the devil can get to you the most. So that's just I just want to hear your comment on that. I think that they should just have more wrecks, you know, in the cities. Oh, one more quick thing. In Texas, when they were building million-dollar stadiums for them schools, they had stadiums like professional stadiums for the schools. I didn't see a lot of the same problems that I seen in the inner cities in Baltimore that they was having in the inner cities in Texas, even though their cities was like five times larger than Baltimore City. And I listened to your comment off the air.
Okay.
So, sir, you have put your finger on a critical issue here, and that is recreation center and providing avenues of growth for our young people. So if I were mayor, sir, I would make sure that we double what we have as far as recreation centers. Now, here's the issue. The issue is, how do you pay for it? So what I would do is I would engage in the business community, and not just the local business community, the national business community, to be sponsors of these rec environments. But I would change the name from rec environment to tech environments. And what I mean by that is let's bring in the recreation. We still, you know, have basketball and ping pong and tennis and pool, but at the same time bring in computer labs to be a part of that rec center. To bring in systems where these children who may not have a safe environment at home can have a safe environment at these centers. So yes, sir, that would be a key part of what I would try to implement as mayor.
It almost sounds like you would view the recreation center as an extension of the educational the public education system, as opposed
by all means. I'm sorry, Bob.
I would concur with that. Because you know, we today the kids have access to things that we didn't have 20 years ago. We didn't have the internet,
right.
and so recreation
right.
centers were almost exclusively for exercise, and that's good, and it should be.
Mm-hmm.
But the idea of adding a technology component to the recreation center, is a good one for a number of reasons. First of all, it may provide access to things that the kids don't have even at home. And it definitely would provide an opportunity to extend the learning process from the school building to the recreational building. And I think that's what you were suggesting. Am I right?
Exactly, Bob. So, Bob, look at it like this. So we have to shift the paradigm of how we view a village raising a child, right? So what we have is in Baltimore is a situation where many of our children do not have a safe environment at home where they can grow and where they can learn. So what we have to do as a community, as a village, is to recreate that environment for these children. And I'm suggesting that one of the ways that we recreate it is through what we used to call recreation centers, but I would change that name to tech centers, but that we create a safe environment where these kids can learn in a safe place and an encouraging place. And I think that can be done through these centers. I really do. But it can't be the rest center that you and I grew up with, which is, as you said, Bob, primarily, you know, physical education.
Right.
We can include physical education, but we should also include technology education. We should include how to be a man, how to be a woman, you know, how to handle conflict. This is about, and even Bob, and even I would suggest even having a part of this where it would allow young people to spend the night there, right? Where they can go, they can find a bed and they can sleep and go get ready for school the next day, because we have to recreate the home environment that has been torn down and taken away from our young people.
How do you get discipline back in the schools?
Well, you know what, Bob? I think the same way that we had discipline in schools, that we have a situation where we have a structured environment. I believe in structure. I guess it's the engineer in me. We have a structured environment where people know and it's clear what they're supposed to do, how they're supposed to carry themselves, and a reward system, Bob, that will reward them for making the right choices, for making good choices. That's why I struggled with the squeegee thing, with the squeegee solution, right? Because I understood the spirit of what the mayor and company were trying to do, but I struggle with, why would you reward bad behavior when you have good kids doing good things, doing the right thing, and we're not rewarding them? I struggled with that a little bit, even though I understood the spirit in which it was that idea was put forth.
Okay.
Carlton, can I ask you an honest question, though?
We're coming to the line in this order. Jen, Priyera, William, Sandra, and Ann. But I got a correction on about the parade tomorrow. It seems that the parade will start at the 900 block of Druid Park Drive and Park Circle at 12 noon, not the 5400 block of Park Heights Avenue.
So they're going up instead of coming down?
Yeah, I guess.
Or is Drew Hill down the bottom, or they come from the top and
march
down.
Either they coming down into the park from there, one or the other. Okay. All right.
So let me ask you something, because y'all just said, do we think that the kids can be basically reconstructed or disciplined now? I say no, because how can you discipline a child that has a parent home telling them, only person you got to listen to is me, I don't care who it is? That's, you got to get over that. I know a lot of kids that are living off of that. When they go out,
are you listening, Bob?
The only person they got to listen to is their ignorant parent.
I lost you for a minute. Can you hear me now?
Yes. Yeah, I can hear you. Go ahead, Black.
What I was saying was, how can you discipline children that are now raised in houses? And no slight to my women.
I cannot hear the call.
Because the men need to be back in the house.
It's the engineer talking, Bob.
We'll repeat the question for you.
They're raised in houses where, how can you discipline children when you have women that are instilling in them, only person you need to listen to is me. Nobody else is allowed to touch, say, discipline, rear you but me.
Robert, the question is, it's not really a question. The question is, in homes where kids are being taught by their custodian, whether it be a male, female, father, mother, whoever. But in the homes, there are homes where kids are being taught that only the custodian or parent can has the authority to discipline the child. And so the child then presents his or herself at school with a frame of mind that you aren't my mother, you aren't my father, you don't have a right to tell me what to do. How in the face of that can school-based discipline be expected to be successful?
Yeah, Bob, that's a great question, and it's a very difficult one, because one of the things that made it work for you and I as young men coming up was that there was a partnership,
yes,
right, between the teacher and mom and daddy, right? Mom and daddy and teacher were a partner, along with the principal of the school. There was a partnership. And when you have parents, you know, young parents usually, who have this attitude that the school can't tell my child what to do, then quite frankly, then that child needs to be in a different program. What we cannot allow, gentlemen, we cannot allow a few kids to disrupt the learning experience of the masses of kids.
Absolutely.
And so what happens in our schools now, you got one or two kids who are out of control, and they come in the classroom, disrupt everything, so the kids who want to learn can't learn. That's not right. That's not fair. So if the parents cannot partner or be unwilling to partner with the teacher, then those children should be put in a different path, a different track, so that they don't disrupt the kids who want to learn.
Okay. Jen, you on air.
Yeah, this is Gene, not Jen.
Oh, Gene. Okay.
How you guys doing? Yeah,
fine.
This is a great conversation, but this is what this is centering around. I called in because Doc called in. It's the affirmative action has been struck down, correct? And literally what it means...
No. Affirmative action has been struck down for black people. It's not been struck down.
Yes, it has been set down for black people. Thank you, Bob.
Yes.
Bob, you are right, Bob. Bob, you are right. Yeah. You are as for black people. It's been shut down. Just like you described, you know, when you were talking about Brown versus the Board of Education, what you were talking about was integration. You didn't use the word, but the remedy is integration, right? But all of this is what black people... what we do is... the decisions and policies that we try to implement are centered around a race. The unique program, Morgan had the MBA program, Towson stole it, etc. That's what the other case was basically about. And so all these decisions that we have been making are centered around and based on race. You know, That's what, in essence, is what the problem is. That's why we're going to have to change the strategy completely in how we approached how we move forward on all issues, because just like the HBCUs, admissions is based on race. And this case with Towson is going to be paramount, because this is the launching or the implementation of the war. I declare war. And so and what they're doing is basically they're just dismantling, using reverse integration, the quote unquote HBCUs, not the original land grant HBCUs, because we know that what is it called the Freedmen's Bureau created it, because all the formerly enslaved African Americans were these schools were set up to train them.
You got a question?
And this is what,
you got a question, Gene, for Mr. Wallace.
Yeah, Mr. Wallace, I have a question for you. What are you going to do about low income affordable housing for seniors? Thank you, sir.
That's a great question, sir. I mean, I would do as an engineer is, first of all, assess the situation. So what is the current situation we face now, senior housing? What is the deficit? What is the deficit? And then explore, brainstorm ways in which we can close that deficit. As the overall strategy, sir, what I would tell you is I would integrate the public and private sectors to fix that problem. See, I believe that the problems that we try to solve, if we integrate the public and the private sector and the community, so that the community benefits, right, from that and for that investment of capital, then I think everybody wins. So we get the housing that we need to close the gap. we incentivize and encourage minority businesses to build those places, right? And we provide a wealth path where the wealth that's created can be shared not only with the investors, but with the people in the community. See, that's a mindset change, sir, that we have to engage in. And if I were mayor, those are the kinds of approaches I would take.
Priyera, you on the air.
Good morning to all. I want to have two questions. Mr. Wallace, one of the questions I want to know is, are you going to run for the mayor of Baltimore?
Priyera, that's not going to be answered on this show today.
Okay. Another question. Do you believe for a lot of the young people, things have not been passed down from those who've made it generation-wise? And also, do you think in any group that doesn't know their history, doomed to repeat it, and that's why we have the problems we have, because they don't know their history and don't know who they truly are and what they've been through, those who came before them. Do you attribute that to the problem of today?
Yes, ma'am. That's a great question, ma'am. I think, as Bob may have mentioned, I've written 8 books so far, and my first book was called Black Wealth Through Black Entrepreneurship. And in that book, I talk about, ma'am, the connection between economic opportunity and power, right? And having power. And I do feel, ma'am, there's been a breakdown in that path where some of us who have created economic opportunities have not translated that down to the broader masses. I think, though, ma'am, that's a two-way street. So if I'm a transmitter of good, whether it's capital or knowledge or wealth, whatever, there has to be a receiver on the other end. And if there's not a receiver, although I'm transmitting, and if there's no receiver, then we don't get the connection, the linkage that you're talking about. So we need to work on both ends. Those that have something to transmit that is of value, and then those who need to receive, who have a spirit, a humility of receiving knowledge and direction, and then taking it and doing something with it. I think it's a two-way street, man.
Okay. Let's go to William. We got a couple lines open. 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. And our guest this morning is Robert Wallace, a former candidate for mayor for Baltimore City and a prominent businessman here in Baltimore. Go ahead, William.
All right. Good morning, Carlton. Good morning, Bob. Good morning, Bob. Yes, I agree. Right, how you doing, Bob Wallace? I agree with 90% of what you're saying, and you have my support, because I think that Baltimore needs something new, man, something different. The only thing I disagree with you on is Brandon Scott's conduct. This is what I don't like about Brandon Scott. He's very disrespectful to, I say, the citizens of Baltimore, because he's arrogant. And I don't like the way he addresses the press, man, because I think they have a right to ask questions, because us as the public, we can't ask them questions, you know. And they are like the representative of the public. And all I'm saying is this about that BG&E thing. Now, how can a company like BG&E come in and put something on your property that you own? And then another question is, BG&E and Brandon Scott, I remember in the last election, I voted against that Condor deal. Brandon Scott did a backdoor deal with BG&E, and to me, it's suspect, because as soon as he did that, BG&E announces that they want to put these regulators on people's houses, and I just don't think it's fair. Could you answer that question for me? Why would somebody be a company that has a monopoly like BG&E can come in and do something like that, and you don't think that Brandon Scott works for BG&E?
Well, you know, sir, I agree with everything that you said. I think that the current mayor has had an issue around, I think, not respecting the community and how he responds to them. And like you said, in the press meetings, how he handles the press. I'm not sure who's advising him, but that's an area I think he would need to improve upon. And the press has a right to ask questions. He cannot be defensive in these situations. And it's tough being mayor. Look, I don't kid myself. It's tough. But that's what you do as a leader. You have to stand up there and take the hits, right, and be respectful and respond to the questions of the people. As it pertains to BGE, I'm an engineer, sir, so I can relate to building infrastructure. I have an IT company and an energy company, and I get it. There are infrastructure requirements that BGE has to follow. What I think the breakdown was is that they didn't communicate with the community or engage the community in a way that they would explain why they're doing what they're doing and why it matters. And on top of that, making it clear how the community will benefit by them making this investment in the infrastructure.
Okay. Going to Sandra and J.B. Brown. We got a couple lines open. 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. Our guest today is Robert Bob Wallace.
Robert, before we take the next call, you've mentioned a few times, and other callers have, the concept of community input, community participation, community. What do you do if you're seeking office, or what do you do if you're holding political office and you realize that what the community wants ain't right? I mean, there are communities around the country that don't want black people living in them.
Yes,
there are communities in the country that want black people returned to slavery. So we obviously can't do everything that the community wants.
There are communities in this country that don't even want the history of black people to be taught.
Yes, sir.
In the school system.
So what do you say when you're an elected official, you're a leader, and you recognize that what your community wants is not the right thing to do? What do you do?
Absolutely, Bob. Well, Bob, one thing that guides me is my North Star, right? I have a high authority to answer to than man, right? And so that becomes my North Star. And so what that means is I'm following my North Star. I've got to do what I think is best for the people that I represent, that I serve, even when they don't think it's the right thing. So part of my job as a leader, though, Bob, is to communicate to them at a level of detail that they can at least understand why I have come to this decision. You know, I can't just say, well, do it because I said do it or because I'm the mayor. No. I got to lay out my case, my business case. Folks, this is why I think this is best for us. Excuse me. And at the end of the day, Bob, they may still disagree, but at least they will know. They will know I'm not just making this rule out of the air. Mm-hmm. I've thought through it. I've analyzed it. I've looked at all sides of it. And this is the conclusion I've come to. Here's the reasons why. And I'm going to move in that direction. And there will be times, Bob, there will be times when a leader has to make decisions. And I know this as a CEO of companies. Mm-hmm. But you got to make a decision that's not popular. That's not what people say they understand. But you do it because it's right. It's the right thing to do. And that's what a leader does. And he or she takes the hit. They take the arrows in those moments. But they listen to their North. They follow their North Star. And they do what they think is right.
Okay, let's go to Sandra. You on air?
Yes, good morning to everyone. And to Mr. Wallace. Sir, I'm listening to your conversation. You're just talking. You don't have a clue what to do if you become mayor. You do the
Sandra. First of all, he has not declared. He's not mentioned in Bob
declared.
Well, you're still bringing up about the fact that if he was mayor. That's not why he's on here today.
Okay. Well, he's talking like he's thinking about it, so I'll put it like that. But if he do, he don't have a clue what to do because the powers-to-be will be telling him the same thing they're telling Brandon. You sit down, you cross your legs, and you grin and you skin and you smile and you shake hands, and you don't sign nothing or do nothing until we tell you. And that's just the way it would be if he becomes mayor.
What do you think? What do you think, ma'am? What should anyone who wants to serve as a leader, and recognizes that level of distrust, really, and rightfully so in many cases, distrust in the community? What should that person do to try to reestablish or establish sufficient trust in the people that they seek to serve? What would you do?
You got to get more North Stars to follow because these North Stars ain't working. You got to do a whole new agenda.
You need it.
All this old stuff is not going to work.
I understand that. Everybody says the old, go out with the old, in with the new. We've tried that too. Can you be specific? What if you have? I'm not trying to put you on the spot, but I am putting you on the spot because.
Oh, go ahead. I can take it.
If you have something specific that you think a leader should do to establish public trust in that leader, in his or her leadership, what one thing would you have that leader do?
Build more money.
Pardon me?
Money. Money talks real crap.
How do you put money in the hands of the people? How does a leader do that?
You associate yourself with people who can help you help people so people can help themselves to establish they have money in the community.
All right.
You can't do it if you don't have it. We got a brand new rec center right here. You know who built it? Cal Ripken. Right here down at the bottom of Cherry Hill. He put $1 million in it. It's just open. What he was talking about, rec centers, they already started doing just what he's talking about. Okay. We got it right here. Prime of the art, right here at the bottom of Cherry Hill.
Do you believe that anybody who's working 40 hours a week ought to be paid enough to support their family?
Of course.
So do you
and more okay, and more.
Okay. Do you believe therefore that anybody who's working 40 hours a week in Baltimore, for example, should be making a minimum of $25 an hour, no matter what their job is?
It takes that much to live in Baltimore and more.
I'm sorry.
Yes, and more.
So you would support. Legislation that would increase the minimum wage in Baltimore to $25 an hour.
Why not? The big shots are getting more. They're ripping off the people in Baltimore. Okay. Why not increase it?
All right. Okay.
Until you get your own, these things will be happening. You can't think the white man will give his pound, his wealth, and his money, and you tell him what to do. It don't work like that.
Okay, Sergeant. Appreciate you.
Hey, Bob, can I respond to that?
Sure.
So, you know, I understand the caller's frustration and disappointment. I really do. And I would just ask her and others who might think like that. I would say to them, if I did run for mayor, okay, I would say to them, okay, you know what you're getting from the current mayor and the past mayors, right? You know what you're getting. If you're happy with that, if you're happy with what you've gotten from them, if you're happy with their ability to solve problems and make your life, your quality of life better, then I would say keep supporting them. But I would say if you're not, why not give somebody who has a different approach and a different perspective on governing and leading, why not give them a chance? Okay, because you might get something that might please you, you know, moving forward. I think sometimes our people are afraid of the unknown. They're afraid of the future. And I will say to them, don't be afraid of the future. Embrace it. Learn from it. And hopefully we as a people can get to a higher level.
Okay. Now, I got a full line. Now, listen closely, you guys. I got about 20 minutes to get everybody in. Maybe some others want to call. And and if you have a question for Mr. Wallace, he's got to respond. And, Bob, if I'm just going to kind of ask you, be as brief but concise in your answers as you can, because we only got about 19 minutes here. We're coming to Mark. We're coming to J.B. Brown, James, William, and Sherry. Mark, you on air. Mark, turn your radio down, Mark.
We're coming to
Mark. Okay, I'm going once. I'm going twice.
All right, Mark.
Yep. Gone. I told you to turn your radio down. Let's go to J.B. Brown. J.B.
Well, good afternoon, folks. First of all, I want to say hello to Brother Bob Wallace. I had the opportunity to meet two of his sons and have a dialogue with him and even help to pass out some of the flyers up there on Radicay Avenue because this man does have an agenda and I would certainly, in my 40 years of broadcasting on 7 different stations, I tell you, this, and he's running as an independent, but he's a great guy with a great vision. I want to say that.
Well, first correction is he ain't said he running for nothing. So he ran as an independent.
That, sir. I didn't say that. I said when he was.
No. You said running.
You did say that.
You said he is running, and he didn't say anything about running.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so one correct.
I appreciate you.
Go ahead.
Anyway, Mr. Wallace is a great man. He's a great person. Bob, it was a pleasure talking to you and your sons, okay? Now,
thank you so much.
The Shields, I want to know who's taking care of your laundry now and your banking. Because when you and Elijah was at the office together, you know, I did both for you, the two of you, taking care of banking and taking care of your shirts. So who's doing that for you now?
I'll talk to you about that off the air.
JB, how you been, man?
Hey, man, well, you know, I've had a couple operations, and I want to talk to you later on, Carlton, but I do want to say this, that Mr. Billups and Miss Roundtree, well, you know, she dealt with both of them, taught us both.
Right,
you know,
right.
You and I were schoolmates, and I was at Harlem Park later on because Rick Thornton, who became the principal later on when I was at Web Radio, he asked me to come back and be an inspiration to the kids, and I got a plan that worked, and we invited Clint Coleman when Schmuck was in office, and we had a program called the SWATters team. SWAT is Special Weapons and Tactics, and SWATter stood for Students with Aversions to All Rules. I want to share that plan with you and Brother Dashiell.
Okay. Call us off air. Good to hear from you. A legend in radio.
Yeah.
J.B. Brown. Yeah. I mean, when I say legend, J.B. was like understudied to Rockin' Robin and Johnny O and all that crew.
Plus the oldest.
Thanks, J.B.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. And full disclosure, J.B. and I were in junior high school together.
Oh.
So that's how far we go back.
That means you're just as old as him.
Woo, yes. You're absolutely correct. Let's go to James, William, Sherry, and Ann. James, you're on air. James.
Good morning, Brother Carlton. How are you doing?
Fine.
That's good. Also, good morning to you, Attorney Dashiell.
Good morning.
And also to your guests. I did have a question for Bob Wallace. As far as the, and I apologize if you already answered this, but as far as Ivan Bates and the bill that he was trying to get passed, as far as get the illegal guns from a misdemeanor to a felony, I was just trying to see, was that something that he would also advocate for? Also, just to even look into that simply as a lot of our crimes, violent crimes, are done by repeat violent offenders. And I really think that that's a coalition to a lot of violent crimes being misdemeanors and not felonies. And I'll take my answer off the air. Y'all have a good weekend.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. I do support what Ivan has proposed. Look, we've got to find ways to create ways to get these guns off the street and get the numbers down. As I said in the previous call, we'll never get all of them off the street, but we got to do something to get many of them off the street. You're right, sir. A lot of crimes that are being committed are repeat offenders. So there needs to be strong consequences and strong initiatives to get repeat offenders off the street. Again, because the people they are hurting tend to be black and brown people. So we need to be very aggressive at getting these folks off the street. I support Ivan Bates in that regard.
Well, yes, I'm going to ask you the question that you asked earlier. Who's going to pay for it? I mean, you know, getting people off the street means they got to go somewhere. That means, you know what it costs for a prison bed. I mean, we live in an era politically where you know, the mantra is no new taxes. Now, Hogan avoided it by gutting the payroll of most of the state agencies and not filling positions. Ehrlich did it by changing all the fees on everything from dog licenses to marriage licenses.
And mortician's licenses.
The fact that and Stuart Pittman in Anne Arundel County has finally admitted to the people that he can't provide core services without increasing the taxes. Where's the money going to come from to pay for more prisons? Because when people talk about accountability and consequences, really they're saying lock them up, in my opinion. I think that's what. So where are you going to lock them up into? Who's going to build the jails and who's going to pay for them?
Yeah, Bob. Bob, that's a great question, Bob. I mean, it always comes down to the dollars, right? Yeah. One of the challenges that Baltimore faces, Bob and Carlton, is that you've got an increasing population that is in need of services. You got a decreasing population that can pay the tax revenue to meet those services. That is not sustainable.
Right.
And so in Baltimore, we have a high concentration of poverty, right? Which is not the people's fault, but we do. And we have a decreasing population. People are moving out of the city who can pay taxes, the tax revenue,
right,
to pay for these services. That is just not sustainable. All I'm suggesting, Obama, is we cannot allow men and women who decide to use a gun to take somebody's life or maim someone, we cannot allow them to stay on the street. Now, what we do with them, we can have that discussion and brainstorm what we do with that. But we cannot allow them to stay on the street. And, you know, I'm a black man, and I'm very sensitive to how the criminal system has been used to hurt us, to hold us back. But at the same time, you got to address this violence that is impacting our communities.
Well,
I
couldn't agree with you more. I mean, you know, that's the thing. You know, we've spent a lot of time talking about what's the difference between Democrats and Republicans. The fact of the matter is there's more things in common than there are differences. Everybody agrees.
That's right.
Everybody agrees right. That we want people who illegally use handguns off the street. The problem is they don't walk around with signs on their back saying I'm about to use a gun illegally.
Yeah.
And they don't walk around with signs on saying I'm mentally unstable. Yeah. Or they don't walk around with signs saying, Lord, you know, yesterday I was okay, but today I didn't take my medication.
My Lord. My Lord. Yeah, Bob. Hey, Bob. Hold it, Bob.
Let me
get
it.
Hello? Okay,
let me,
go ahead, call me.
Yeah, William, you're on air.
No, this is Mark.
Oh, Mark. Go ahead.
Yeah, how y'all doing?
All right.
How y'all doing? And Mr. Wallace, once Sheila Dixon lost, I voted for you for a lot of the reasons that you said. But here in Baltimore, I was out in Brooklyn, you know, and a lot of the stuff, Colin, that they said to me, and when we was out there Monday, they didn't want to say to the news. They say they felt neglected. They've been doing that festival for 27 years. That's another thing. And Carlton, they had the real big mobile unit that we've been crying for all over out there after the event. You know, and I'm with Grandma. Let me say what Grandma said before I ask my question. The grandmother of that young lady that was murdered, because they knew out, you know, long time before it happened, said that the police dropped the ball, that they're making excuses, and that she's not buying it. And we don't want police to save us, Mr. Wallace. We just, and you've said it, I've said it, we want police and politicians just to do the job that we paid for. I believe if you or other leaders had money, like $600 million, it would have been spent in a totally different way. And the condor, that's what I'm going to ask you about. We're smart. We're smart voters here in Baltimore. That's why he only won with 25-30% of the vote. But with the conduit bill, we voted on the charter that we didn't want our conduit given away. And those white ladies in Federal Hill got locked up because they didn't want that stuff out in front of their house. So BD&E is doing whatever they want right now. And I believe it was a big influx of money up front, and that's why he did it. And he just ignored what we say. I think that's a deal breaker, Carlton, as far as I'm concerned. I'll talk to y'all later. And I'll be on this Sunday at 5 o'clock.
All right, Mark. Okay, any response to that quickly, Bob, or anything? Or?
No, I think Mark's right on the money. Look, I'm an engineer, as I said. I understand. I've worked with the conduit for 30 years in terms of doing IT, you know, work and through it. It is a major asset for the city. And we need to make sure that all of our assets are properly protected and that they're properly used to benefit the people. That's the North Star for me. That's the principle that would need to be followed.
Okay, we're coming to Sherry. And then the last caller for today is going to be Jay. Sherry, you on air.
Yes, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Mr. Wallace, a specific question. Do you think I am a black African-American Republican woman. Do you think we in the Al community get too caught up on the race card without actually looking for what each candidate is going to do? Me, I want to ask you this and see how you're going to answer it. By me being a black Republican woman, and I will vote for the previous administration, and I stand for, do you consider me still black, or I want to be white? I'm going to tell you right now, I will always be black. I just vote my interest. Have a good day, Jim, and I want to hear your answer to that question. Have a good day.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Shaq.
Yes, ma'am.
Go ahead, Bob.
I mean, all of us should vote our interests, our special interests. And I think that whether Republican or independent or Democrat, I mean, look, I've been a Republican, I've been a Democrat, I've been an independent. And what I tell people is, as you said, man, vote what is best for you. Forget about party. What ideas are they bringing to the table to solve the problems that impact your quality of life? So whether you're Republican, Democrat, independent, if I'm your leader, I'm going to support you and do what's best for you, regardless of your party.
And you're on the air. And?
Hello?
Yes, you're on the air.
Okay, I missed it before. I have a couple of things I want to say. Mr. Bob.
Well, cut it short. Cut it short.
Okay, wait a minute. I'm telling him I like him. Tell Mr. Wallace, we black people vote for people of our race who will go in there and find out all these underhanded things that the other race do to us. They get on TV, they can tell you everything they can do. Then when they get in there and you ask them questions, they all got a stammering problem. They cannot come out and tell you anything. And as far as black people, we have all been poor in a certain amount of, we always have been poor. You know, we ain't never been rich. You know, some of us is, some not. But they all, the black kids is doing things that we have never did. Never did. And we all had problems with being poor and in a certain neighborhood. But when the family structure broke down, then that's when everything break down. And then when when the black leaders get in there and they say they want to do this and that, it's a lot of money is being poured into the city. And they're doing nothing but putting it in their pocket. There is no reason why they can't see what's going on with the black race in this country. It's a disgrace.
Thank you, Ann. Last caller for today, Jay, you're on air.
Yes, good morning, everyone. Pray that all is well with all of you. I wanted to talk about a possible resolution for the crime.
Do you have a question for Mr. Wallace?
I wanted to give my statement to see if how he felt about that. Is that okay?
Yeah, don't make a statement. If you got a question for him, go ahead and ask it.
Okay. The question would be, would you agree to how I would implement or how I foresee part of the resolution for reducing the crime and changing our young people's mindsets in Baltimore City? When I originally started listening today, a gentleman was saying that there was no resolution, but like we're gone astray. And I would get the community together. I would have the police department. I would get.
Now you're trying to answer the question that you're asking. Now let him answer the question because we up against the time, darling. Okay, right. Let him answer your question.
So Carlton, I think where this call is going is where I would go as well, and that is engagement of every aspect of our community to brainstorm on this and figure out what is the best path forward. And I think it cannot be just in the vacuum of City Hall and the police department. I mean, we got to have people like your caller and the community having input on this to come to the best solution. So I would hold a major conference if I were to come in and solicit these ideas from people like your caller so we come up with the best solution.
Bob, we just have a couple minutes, but first of all, I want to thank you for taking time out from your busy schedule and plus the fact that where you are was hard to get through, But we've managed for the last couple hours, and we appreciate that. Want to ask you your opinion on, okay, we got a new governor, the first black governor in the state. Briefly, can you give me what's your synopsis of how he's been doing thus far, and what do you wish that he will do in the future?
Well, I think he's, let's see. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. I think he's doing a great job. Look, I know Westmore, and I support his campaign. And I think he's a good man. I think he's a smart man. I think he's got a good heart. And I think he's in the right place. I think he's going to come to a point, though, Carlton, where he's going to have to make some hard decisions that might be contrary to maybe various groups that supported him as governor. And I think he's up for the challenge. I think he's up to make decisions that are best for the people, even when it may be unpopular, or it may rub some people the wrong way. So I think Carlton, he's doing a great job.
Okay. Well, we certainly thank you, Bob, for taking time out from your busy schedule. When you get back in town and you have some time, give me a call off air. We certainly would love to have you back in the future. You know, now I will be up front. If you do happen to announce, we can't bring you back. But if there's any thing in the future that you might want to discuss or anything, we certainly, you're a breath of fresh air, I have to say, and I certainly want to thank Bob DeShields for making contact with you to get you on with us, and we appreciate you and respect you and love you. Thank you so much.
Well, we love you. I love you guys too, Carlton and Bob. And thank you all for what you do.
Thanks,
to make our city better. So keep fighting. Don't give up.
All right. Thanks, you.
Robert.
Final thoughts, Robert.
Final thought. Life is not a snapshot. It's a motion picture. So be careful of those who give you a snapshot and say this is what the world was or what it needs to be. Consider the things and think intelligently about what's in your own best interest. Robert DeShiel, 410-547-8820.
And this has been Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, telephone number is 410-669-1738. Want to thank Brother Black for being in with us today, guiding us through the maze that we'd had to go through. And as I always say, take your head with your ear, put it to the ground. Listen to the grass grow. See ya. Don't want to be ya. Bye. His father works someday.